The Age of Empathy: Nature's Lessons for a Kinder Society, by Frans de Waal. Narrated by Alan Sklar. Copyright 2009 by Frans de Waal. This unabridged audiobook is published by arrangement with Harmony Books, an imprint of the Crown Publishing Group, a division of Random House Incorporated, and was produced in the year 2009 by Tantor Media Incorporated, which holds the copyright thereto. Preface. Greed is out. Empathy is in. The global financial crisis of 2008, together with the election of a new American president, has produced a seismic shift in society. Many have felt as if they were waking up from a bad dream about a big casino where the people's money had been gambled away, enriching a happy few without the slightest worry about the rest of us. This nightmare was set in motion a quarter century earlier by Reagan-Thatcher trickle-down economics and the soothing reassurance that markets are wonderful at self-regulation. No one believes this anymore. American politics seems poised for a new epoch that stresses cooperation and social responsibility. The emphasis is on what unites a society, what makes it worth living in, rather than what material wealth we can extract from it. Empathy is the grand theme of our time, as reflected in the speeches of Barack Obama, such as when he told graduates at Northwestern University in Chicago, "I think we should talk more about our empathy deficit." It's only when you hitch your wagon to something larger than yourself that you will realize your true potential. The message of the Age of Empathy is that human nature offers a giant helping hand in this endeavor. True, biology is usually called upon to justify a society based on selfish principles. But we should never forget that it has also produced the glue that holds communities together. This glue is the same for us as for many other animals. Being in tune with others, coordinating activities, and caring for those in need isn't restricted to our species. Human empathy has the backing of a long evolutionary history, which is the second meaning of age in this book's title. Chapter 1. Biology, Left and Right. What is government itself but the greatest of all reflections on human nature? James Madison, 1788. Are we our brother's keepers? Should we be? Or would this role only interfere with why we are on earth, which according to economists is to consume and produce, and according to biologists is to survive and reproduce? That both views sound similar is logical, given that they arose at around the same time, in the same place, during the English Industrial Revolution. Both follow a competition is good for you logic. Slightly earlier, and slightly to the north, in Scotland, the thinking was different. The father of economics, Adam Smith, understood as no other that the pursuit of self-interest needs to be tempered by fellow-feeling. He said so in The Theory of Moral Sentiments, a book not nearly as popular as his later work, The Wealth of Nations. He famously opened his first book with, "How selfish soever man may be supposed, there are evidently some principles in his nature which interest him in the fortune of others, and render their happiness necessary to him, though he derives nothing from it except the pleasure of seeing it." The French revolutionaries chanted of fraternité. Abraham Lincoln appealed to the bonds of sympathy, and Theodore Roosevelt spoke glowingly of fellow feeling as the most important factor in producing a healthy political and social life. But if this is true, why is this sentiment sometimes ridiculed as being, well, sentimental? A recent example occurred after Hurricane Katrina struck Louisiana in 2005. While the American people were transfixed by the unprecedented catastrophe, one cable news network saw fit to ask if the Constitution actually provides for disaster relief. A guest on the show argued that the misery of others is none of our business. The day the levees broke, I happened to be driving down from Atlanta to Alabama to give a lecture at Auburn University. Except for a few fallen trees, this part of Alabama had suffered little damage, but the hotel was full of refugees. People had crammed the rooms with grandparents, children, dogs, and cats. I woke up at a zoo. Not the strangest place for a biologist, perhaps, but it conveyed the size of the calamity, and these people were the lucky ones. The morning newspaper at my door screamed, "Why have we been left behind like animals?" A quote from one of the people stuck for days without food and sanitation in the Louisiana Superdome. I took issue with this headline, not because I felt there was nothing to complain about, but because animals don't necessarily leave one another behind. My lecture was on precisely this topic, on how we have an inner ape that is not nearly as callous and nasty as advertised, and how empathy comes naturally to our species. I wasn't claiming that it always finds expression, though. Thousands of people with money and cars had fled New Orleans, leaving the sick, old, and poor to fend for themselves. In some places, dead bodies floated in the water, where they were being eaten by alligators. But immediately following the disaster, there was also deep embarrassment in the nation about what had happened, and an incredible outpouring of support. Sympathy was not absent, it was just late in coming. Americans are a generous people, yet raised with the mistaken belief that the invisible hand of the free market, a metaphor introduced by the same Adam Smith, will take care of society's woes. The invisible hand, however, did nothing to prevent the appalling survival of the fittest scenes in New Orleans. The ugly secret of economic success is that it sometimes comes at the expense of public funding, thus creating a giant underclass that no one cares about. Katrina exposed the underbelly of American society. On my drive back to Atlanta, it occurred to me that this is the theme of our time, the common good. We tend to focus on wars, terror threats, globalization, and petty political scandals. Yet the larger issue is how to combine a thriving economy with a humane society. It relates to health care, education, justice, and as illustrated by Katrina, protection against nature. The levees in Louisiana had been criminally neglected. In the weeks following the flooding, the media were busy finger-pointing. Had the engineers been at fault? Had funds been diverted? Shouldn't the president have broken off his vacation? Where I come from, fingers belong in the dike. Or at least that's how legend has it. In the Netherlands, much of which lies up to 20 feet below sea level, dikes are so sacred that politicians have literally no say over them. Water management is in the hands of engineers and local citizen boards that predate the nation itself. Come to think of it, this also reflects a distrust of government. Not so much big government, but rather the short-sightedness of most politicians. Evolutionary spirit. How people organize their societies may not seem the sort of topic a biologist should worry about. I should be concerned with the ivory-billed woodpecker, the role of primates in the spread of AIDS or Ebola, the disappearance of tropical rainforests, or whether we evolved from the apes. whereas the latter remains an issue for some. There has nevertheless been a dramatic shift in public opinion regarding the role of biology. The days are behind us when E.O. Wilson was showered with cold water after a lecture on the connection between animal and human behavior. Greater openness to parallels with animals makes life easier for the biologist, hence my decision to go to the next level and see if biology can shed light on human society. If this means wading right into political controversy, so be it. It's not as if biology is not already a part of it. Every debate about society and government makes huge assumptions about human nature, which are presented as if they come straight out of biology, but they almost never do. Lovers of open competition, for example, often invoke evolution. The E word even slipped into the infamous greed speech of Gordon Gekko, the ruthless corporate raider played by Michael Douglas in the 1987 movie Wall Street. The point is, ladies and gentlemen, that greed, for lack of a better word, is good. Greed is right. Greed works. Greed clarifies, cuts through, and captures the essence of the evolutionary spirit. The evolutionary spirit? Why are assumptions about biology always on the negative side? In the social sciences, human nature is typified by the old Hobbesian proverb, Homo homini lupus, man is wolf to man. A questionable statement about our own species based on false assumptions about another species. A biologist exploring the interaction between society and human nature really isn't doing anything new, therefore. The only difference is that instead of trying to justify a particular ideological framework, the biologist has an actual interest in the question of what human nature is and where it came from. Is the evolutionary spirit really all about greed, as Gekko claimed? Or is there more to it? Students of law, economics, and politics lack the tools to look at their own society with any objectivity. What are they going to compare it with? They rarely, if ever, consult the vast knowledge of human behavior accumulated in anthropology, psychology, biology, or neuroscience. The short answer, derived from the latter disciplines, is that we are group animals, highly cooperative, sensitive to injustice, sometimes warmongering, but mostly peace-loving. A society that ignores these tendencies can't be optimal. True, we are also incentive-driven animals, focused on status, territory, and food security, so that any society that ignores those tendencies can't be optimal either. There is both a social and a selfish side to our species, but since the latter is, at least in the West, the dominant assumption, my focus will be on the former, the role of empathy and social connectedness. There is exciting new research about the origins of altruism and fairness in both ourselves and other animals. For example, if one gives two monkeys hugely different rewards for the same task, the one who gets the short end of the stick simply refuses to perform. In our own species, too, individuals reject income if they feel the distribution is unfair. Since any income should beat none at all, this means that both monkeys and people fail to follow the profit principle to the letter. By protesting against unfairness, their behavior supports both the claim that incentives matter and that there is a natural dislike of injustice. Yet in some ways, we seem to be moving ever closer to a society with no solidarity whatsoever, one in which a lot of people can expect the short end of the stick. To reconcile this trend with good old Christian values, such as care for the sick and poor, may seem hopeless. But one common strategy is to point the finger at the victims. If the poor can be blamed for being poor, everyone else is off the hook. Thus, a year after Katrina, Newt Gingrich, a prominent conservative politician, called for an investigation into the failure of citizenship, of people who had been unsuccessful escaping from the hurricane. Those who highlight individual freedom often regard collective interests as a romantic notion, something for sissies and communists. They prefer an every-man-for-himself logic. For example, instead of spending money on levees that protect an entire region, why not let everyone take care of their own safety? A new company in Florida is doing just that, renting out seats on private jets to fly people out of places threatened by hurricanes. This way, those who can afford it won't need to drive out at 5 miles per hour with the rest of the populace. Every society has to deal with this me-first attitude. I see it play out every day. And here, I am not referring to people, but to chimpanzees at the Yerkes National Primate Research Center, where I work. At our field station northeast of Atlanta, we house chimps in large outdoor corrals, sometimes providing them with shareable food such as watermelons. Most of the apes want to be the first to put their hands on our food, because once they have it, it's rarely taken away by others. There actually exists respective ownership, so that even the lowest-ranking female is allowed to keep her food by the most dominant male. Food possessors are often approached by others with an outstretched hand, a gesture that is also the universal way humans ask for a handout. The apes beg and whine, literally whimpering in the face of the other. If the possessor doesn't give in, beggars may throw a fit, screaming and rolling around as if the world is coming to an end. My point is that there is both ownership and sharing. In the end, usually within 20 minutes, all of the chimpanzees in the group will have some food. Owners share with their best buddies and family, who in turn share with their best buddies and family. It is a rather peaceful scene, even though there is also quite a bit of jostling for position. I still remember a camera crew filming a sharing session, and the cameraman turning to me and saying, "I should show this to my kids. They could learn from it." So don't believe anyone who says that since nature is based on a struggle for life, we need to live like this as well. Many animals survive not by eliminating each other or keeping everything for themselves, but by cooperating and sharing. This applies most definitely to pack hunters, such as wolves or killer whales, but also to our closest relatives, the primates. In a study done at Thai National Park in Ivory Coast, chimpanzees took care of group mates wounded by leopards. They licked their mate's blood, carefully removed dirt, and waved away flies that came near the wounds. They protected injured companions and slowed down during travel in order to accommodate them. All of this makes perfect sense, given that chimpanzees live in groups for a reason, the same way wolves and humans are group animals for a reason. If man is wolf to man, he is so in every sense, not just the negative one. We would not be where we are today had our ancestors been socially aloof. What we need is a complete overhaul of assumptions about human nature. Too many economists and politicians model human society on the perpetual struggle they believe exists in nature, but which is a mere projection. Like magicians, they first throw their ideological prejudices into the hat of nature, then pull them out by their very ears to show how much nature agrees with them. It's a trick we have fallen for far too long. Obviously, competition is part of the picture, but humans can't live by competition alone. The Overkissed Child. The German philosopher Immanuel Kant saw as little value in human kindness as former U.S. Vice President Dick Cheney did in energy conservation. Cheney mocked conservation as a sign of personal virtue that sadly wouldn't do the planet any good. Kant praised compassion as beautiful, yet considered it irrelevant to a virtuous life. Who needs tender feelings if duty is all that matters? We live in an age that celebrates the cerebral and looks down upon emotions as mushy and messy. Worse, emotions are hard to control. And isn't self-control what makes us human? Like hermits resisting life's temptations, modern philosophers try to keep human passions at arm's length and focus on logic and reason instead. But just as no hermit can avoid dreaming of pretty maidens and good meals, no philosopher can get around the basic needs, desires, and obsessions of a species that, unfortunately for them, actually is made of flesh and blood. The notion of pure reason is pure fiction. If morality is derived from abstract principles, why do judgments often come instantaneously? We hardly need to think about them. In fact, psychologist Jonathan Haidt believes we arrive at them intuitively. He presented human subjects with stories of odd behavior, such as a one-night stand between a brother and sister, which the subjects immediately disapproved of. He then challenged every single reason they could come up with for their rejection of incest, until his subjects ran out of reasons. They might say that incest leads to abnormal offspring, but in Haidt's story, the siblings used effective contraception, which took care of this argument. Most of his subjects quickly reached the stage of moral dumbfounding. They stubbornly insisted the behavior was wrong without being able to say why. Clearly, we often make snap moral decisions that come from the gut. Our emotions decide, after which our reasoning power tries to catch up as spin doctor, concocting plausible justifications. With this dent in the primacy of human logic, pre-Kantian approaches to morality are making a comeback. They anchor morality in the so-called sentiments, a view that fits well with evolutionary theory, modern neuroscience, and the behavior of our primate relatives. This is not to say that monkeys and apes are moral beings, but I do agree with Darwin, who, in The Descent of Man, saw human morality as derived from animal sociality. Any animal whatever, endowed with well-marked social instincts, would inevitably acquire a moral sense or conscience as soon as its intellectual powers had become as well-developed or nearly as well-developed as in man. What are these social instincts? What is it that makes us care about the behavior of others, or about others, period? Moral judgment obviously goes further than this, but an interest in others is fundamental. Where would human morality be without it? It's the bedrock upon which everything else is constructed. Much occurs on a bodily level that we rarely think about. We listen to someone telling a sad story, and unconsciously we drop our shoulders, tilt our head sideways like the other, copy his or her frown, and so on. These bodily changes, in turn, create the same dejected state in us as we perceive in the other. Rather than our head getting into the other's head, it's our body that maps the other's. The same applies to happier emotions. I remember one morning walking out of a restaurant and wondering why I was whistling to myself. How did I get into such a good mood? The answer I had been sitting near two men, obviously old friends, who hadn't seen each other in a long time. They had been slapping each other's backs and laughing, relating amusing stories. This must have lifted my spirit, even though I didn't know these men and hadn't been privy to their conversation. Mood transfer via facial expressions and body language is so powerful that people doing it on a daily basis literally start to look alike. This has been tested with portraits of long-time couples. One set of pictures was taken on their wedding day, and another set 25 years later. Presented with separate portraits of these men and women, human subjects were asked to match them on similarity. For the set taken at an older age, they had no trouble deciding who was married to whom. But for the pictures taken at a younger age, subjects flunked the task. Married couples resemble each other, therefore, not because they pick partners who look like them, but because their features converge over the years. The similarity was strongest for couples who reported the greatest happiness. Daily sharing of emotions apparently leads one partner to internalize the other, and vice versa, to the point that anyone can see how much they belong together. I can't resist throwing in here that dog owners and their pets also sometimes look alike. But this isn't the same. We can correctly pair photographs of people and their dogs only if the dogs are purebreds. It doesn't work with mutts. Purebreds, of course, are carefully selected by their owners, who pay high sums for them. An elegant lady may want to walk a wolfhound, whereas an assertive character may prefer a Rottweiler. Since similarity doesn't increase with the number of years that owners have had their pets, the critical factor is the choice of breed. This is quite different from the emotional convergence between spouses. Our bodies and minds are made for social life, and we become hopelessly depressed in its absence. This is why, next to death, solitary confinement is our worst punishment. Bonding is so good for us that the most reliable way to extend one's life expectancy is to marry and stay married. The flip side is the risk we run after losing a partner. The death of a spouse often leads to despair and a reduced will to live that explains the car accidents, alcohol abuse, heart disease, and cancers that take the lives of those left behind. Mortality remains elevated for about half a year following a spouse's death. It is worse for younger than older people, and worse for men than women. For animals, things are no different. I myself have lost two pets this way. The first was a jackdaw, a crow-like bird that I had reared by hand. Johan was tame and friendly, but not attached to me. The love of his life was a female of his species named Raffia. They were together for years until Raffia one day escaped from the outdoor aviary. I suspect that a neighbor child had gotten curious and unlatched the door. Left behind, Johan spent days calling and scanning the sky. He died within weeks. And then there was our Siamese cat, Sarah, who had been adopted as a kitten by our big tomcat, Diego, who would lick and clean her, let her knead his tummy as if she were nursing, and sleep with her. For about a decade they were best buddies, until Diego died of old age. Even though Sarah was younger and in perfect health, she stopped eating and died 2 months after Diego for no reason that the veterinarian could determine. There exist, of course, thousands of such stories, including of animals that refuse to let go of loved ones. It is not unusual for primate mothers to carry their dead infants around until there's nothing left of them but skin and bones. A baboon female in Kenya, who had recently lost her infant, got extremely agitated when a week later she recognized the same bush on the savanna where she'd left its body. She climbed a high tree from which to scan, while uttering plaintive calls normally used by baboons, separated from their troop. Elephants, too, are known to return to the remains of dead companions, to solemnly stand over their sun-bleached bones. They may take an hour to gently turn the bones over and over, smelling them. Sometimes they carry off bones, but other elephants have been seen returning them to the grave site. Impressed by animal loyalty, humans have dedicated statues to it. In Edinburgh, Scotland, there's a little sculpture of Greyfriars Bobby, a Skye terrier who refused to leave the grave of his master, buried in 1858. For 14 whole years, Bobby guarded the grave while being fed by his fans, until he died and was buried not far away. His headstone reads, "Let his loyalty and devotion be a lesson to us all." A similar statue exists in Tokyo for an Akita dog named Achiko, who every day used to come to Shibuya Station to greet his master returning from work. The dog became famous for continuing this habit after his master had died in 1925. For 11 years, Achiko waited at the appropriate time at the station. Dog lovers still gather once a year at the exit, now named after Achiko, to pay homage to his faithfulness. Touching stories, one might say. But what do they have to do with human behavior? The point is that we are mammals, which are animals with obligatory maternal care. Obviously, bonding has incredible survival value for us, the most critical bond being the one between mother and offspring. This bond provides the evolutionary template for all other attachments, including those among adults. We shouldn't be surprised, therefore, if humans in love tend to regress to the parent-offspring stage, feeding each other tidbits as if they can't eat by themselves, and talking nonsense with the same high-pitched voices normally reserved for babies. I myself grew up with the Beatles' love song lyrics, "I wanna hold your hand," another regression. One set of animal studies has, in fact, had a huge, concrete influence on how humans treat one another. A century ago, foundling homes and orphanages followed the advice of a school of psychology that, in my opinion, has wreaked more havoc than any other: behaviorism. Its name reflects the belief that behavior is all that science can see and know, and therefore all it should care about. The mind, if such a thing even exists, remains a black box. Emotions are largely irrelevant. This attitude led to a taboo on the inner life of animals. Animals were to be described as machines, and students of animal behavior were to develop a terminology devoid of human connotations. Ironically, this advice backfired with at least one term. Bonding was originally coined to avoid anthropomorphic labels for animals, such as friends or buddies. But the term has become so popular for human relationships, as in male bonding or bonding experience, that now we probably will have to drop it for animals. That humans are controlled by the same law of effect as animals was convincingly demonstrated by the father of behaviorism, John Watson, who inculcated in a human baby a phobia for hairy objects. At first, little Albert happily played with the white rabbit he had been given. But after Watson paired each appearance of the rabbit with the loud clanging of steel objects right behind poor Albert's head, fear was the inevitable outcome. From then on, Albert placed his hands over his eyes and whimpered each time he saw the rabbit or the investigator. Watson was so enamored by the power of conditioning that he became allergic to emotions. He was particularly skeptical of maternal love, which he considered a dangerous instrument. Fussing over their children, mothers were ruining them by instilling weaknesses, fears, and inferiorities. Society needed less warmth and more structure. Watson dreamed of a baby farm without parents, so that infants could be raised according to scientific principles. For example, a child should be touched only if it has behaved incredibly well, and not with a hug or kiss, but rather with a little pat on the head. Physical rewards that are systematically meted out would do wonders, Watson felt, and were far superior to the mawkish rearing style of the average well-meaning mom. Unfortunately, environments like the baby farm existed, and all we can say about them is that they were deadly. This became clear when psychologists studied orphans kept in little cribs separated by white sheets, deprived of visual stimulation and body contact. As recommended by scientists, the orphans had never been cooed at, held, or tickled. They looked like zombies, with immobile faces and wide-open, expressionless eyes. Had Watson been right, these children should have been thriving, but they in fact lacked all resistance to disease. At some orphanages, mortality approached 100%. Watson's crusade against what he called the over-kissed child and the immense respect accorded him in 1920s public opinion seem incomprehensible today, but explains why another psychologist, Harry Harlow, set out to prove the obvious, which is that maternal love matters. To monkeys. At a primate laboratory in Madison, Wisconsin, Harlow demonstrated that monkeys reared in isolation were mentally and socially disturbed. When put in a group, they lacked the tendency, let alone the skill, to interact socially. As adults, they couldn't even copulate or nurse offspring. Whatever we now think of the ethics of Harlow's research, he proved beyond any doubt that deprivation of body contact is not something that suits mammals. With time, this kind of research changed the tide and helped improve the fate of human orphans, except, that is, in Romania, where President Nicolae Ceausescu created an emotional gulag by raising thousands of newborns in institutions. The world got a reminder of the nightmare of deprivation rearing when Ceausescu's orphanages opened after the fall of the Iron Curtain. The orphans were incapable of laughing or crying, spent the day rocking and clutching themselves in a fetal position, strikingly similar to Harlow's monkeys, and didn't even know how to play. New toys were hurled against the wall. Bonding is essential for our species, and it is what makes us happiest. And here I don't mean the sort of jumping for joy bliss that the French leader General Charles de Gaulle must have had in mind when he allegedly sneered that happiness is for idiots. The pursuit of happiness written into the U.S. Declaration of Independence rather refers to a state of satisfaction with the life one is living. This is a measurable state, and studies show that beyond a certain basic income, material wealth carries remarkably little weight. The standard of living has been rising steadily for decades, but has it changed our happiness quotient? Not at all. Rather than money, success, or fame, time spent with friends and family is what does people the most good. We take the importance of social networks for granted to the point that we sometimes overlook them. This happened to my team of primate experts, even though we should have known better, when we built a new climbing structure for our chimpanzees. We focused too much on the physical environment. For more than 30 years, the apes had lived in the same outdoor enclosure, a large open area equipped with metal jungle gyms. We decided to get large telephone poles and bolt them together into something more exciting. During the construction, the chimps were locked up next to the site. At first, they were noisy and restless, but upon hearing the huge machine that put in the poles, they turned silent for the rest of the time. They could hear that this was serious business. The poles were connected with ropes. We planted new grass, dug new drains, and 8 days later we were ready. The new structure was 10 times taller than the one we had before. At least 30 workers of the field station came to watch the release. We even had a betting pool about which chimp would be the first to touch wood or climb to the top. These apes had not smelled or touched wood for decades. Some of them never had. As one might imagine, the director of the primate center guessed that the highest-ranking male and female would be the first, but we knew that male chimps are no heroes. They are always busy improving their political position, taking great risks in the process, but they literally get diarrhea of fear as soon as something new comes around the corner. Standing in the tower, overlooking the compound with all cameras running, we released the colony. The first thing that happened was unexpected. We were so enamored with our wonderful construction, which had taken so much sweat to cobble together in the summer heat, that we had forgotten that the apes had been locked up for days in separate cages, even separate buildings. The first minutes following the release were all about social connections. Some chimps literally jumped into each other's arms, embracing and kissing. Within a minute, the adult males were giving intimidation displays, with all their hair on end, lest anyone might have forgotten who was boss. The chimps barely seemed to notice the new construction. Some of them walked right underneath it, as if it were invisible. They seemed in denial, until they noticed the bananas we had placed at strategic locations visible from the ground. The first ones to get into the structure were the older females, and ironically, the very last chimp to touch wood was a female known as the group's bully. As soon as the fruits had been collected and eaten, though, everyone left the structure. They clearly weren't ready for it. They gathered in the old metal jungle gym, which my students had tested out the day before, finding it most uncomfortable to sit on. But the chimps had known it all their lives, so they lazily lay around in it, looking up at the Taj Mahal that we had erected next to it, as if it were an object to be studied rather than enjoyed. It was months before they spent significant amounts of time in the new climbing frame. We had been blinded by our own proud achievement, only to be corrected by the apes, who reminded us of the basics. It made me think again of Immanuel Kant, because isn't this the problem with modern philosophy? Obsessed by what we consider new and important about ourselves, abstract thought, conscience, morality, we overlook the fundamentals. I'm not trying to belittle what is uniquely human, but if we ever want to understand how we got there, we will need to start thinking from the bottom up. Instead of fixating on the peaks of civilization, we need to pay attention to the foothills. The peaks glimmer in the sun, but it is in the foothills that we find most of what drives us, including those messy emotions that make us spoil our children. Macho origin myths. It was a typical primate conflict over dinner in a fancy Italian restaurant. One human male challenging another, me, in front of his girlfriend. Knowing my writings, what better target than humanity's place in nature? Name one area in which it's hard to tell humans apart from animals, he said, looking for a test case. Before I knew it, between two bites of delicious pasta, I replied, "The sex act." Perhaps reminded of something unmentionable, I could see that this took him aback a little, but only momentarily. He launched into a great defense of passion as peculiarly human, stressing the recent origin of romantic love, the wonderful poems and serenades that come with it, while poo-pooing my emphasis on the mechanics of l'amore, which are essentially the same for humans, hamsters, and guppies. Male guppies are equipped with a penis-like modified fin. He pulled a deeply disgusted face at these mundane anatomical details. Alas for him, his girlfriend was a colleague of mine, who with great enthusiasm jumped in with more examples of animal sex. So we had the sort of dinner conversation that primatologists love, but that embarrasses almost everyone else. A stunned silence fell at neighboring tables, when the girlfriend exclaimed that he had such an erection. It was unclear if the reaction concerned what she had just said, or that she had indicated what she meant, holding thumb and index finger only slightly apart. She was talking about a small South American monkey. Our argument was never resolved, but by the time desserts arrived, it fortunately had lost steam. Such discussions are a staple of my existence. I believe that we are animals, whereas others believe we are something else entirely. Human uniqueness may be hard to maintain when it comes to sex, but the situation changes if one considers airplanes, parliaments, or skyscrapers. Humans have a truly impressive capacity for culture and technology. Even though many animals do show some elements of culture, if you meet a chimp in the jungle with a camera, you can be pretty sure he didn't produce it himself. But what about humans who have missed out on the cultural growth spurt that much of the world underwent over the last few thousand years? Hidden in far-flung corners, these people do possess all the hallmarks of our species, such as language, art, and fire. We can study how they survive without being distracted by the technological advances of today. Does their way of life fit widely held assumptions about humanity's state of nature, a concept with a rich history in the West? Given the way this concept figured in the French Revolution, the U.S. Constitution, and other historical steps toward modern democracy, it's no trivial matter to establish how humans may have lived in their original state. A good example are the Bushmen of Southwest Africa, who used to live in such simplicity that their lifestyle was lampooned in the 1980 movie, The Gods Must Be Crazy. As a teenager, anthropologist Elizabeth Marshall Thomas went with her parents, also anthropologists, to the Kalahari Desert to live among them. Bushmen, also known as the San, are a small, lithe people who have carved out a very modest niche in a grassy, open ecosystem that for half of the year is so low on water that the few reliable water holes seriously restrict human movement. They have lived this way for thousands and thousands of years, which is why Marshall Thomas titled her book on them, The Old Way. The old way includes minimal clothing made out of antelope hides, a modest grass shelter, a sharpened digging stick, and an ostrich eggshell to transport water on day trips. Shelters are built and rebuilt all the time by putting a few sticks into the ground, intertwining the top, and covering the frame with grass. It reminded Marshall Thomas of the way apes built one-night nests in the trees by quickly weaving a few branches together into a platform before they go to sleep. This way, they stay off the ground, where danger lurks. When bushmen travel, they walk in single file, with a man in the lead who watches out for fresh predator tracks, snakes, and other dangers. Women and children occupy safer positions. This, too, is reminiscent of chimpanzees, who at dangerous moments, such as when they cross a human dirt road, have adult males in the lead and rear, with females and juveniles in between. Sometimes the alpha male stands guard at the road until everyone has crossed it. Our ancestors may have been higher on the food chain than most primates, but they definitely were not at the apex. They had to watch their backs. This brings me to the first false myth about our state of nature, which is that our ancestors rule the savanna. How could this be true for bipedal apes that stood only 4 feet tall? They must have lived in terror of the bear-sized hyenas of those days and the saber-toothed cats that were twice the size of our lions. As a result, they had to content themselves with second-rate hunting time. Darkness is the best cover, but like the Bushmen today, early human hunters likely opted for the heat of the day when their prey could see them coming from miles away, because they had to leave the night to the professional hunters. Lions are the supreme rulers of the savannah, as reflected in our Lion King stories and the Bushmen's high regard for lions. Significantly, Bushmen never use their deadly poison arrows on these animals, knowing that this may start a battle they can't win. The lions leave them alone most of the time, but when for some reason the lions in some places become man-eaters, people have had no choice but to leave. Danger is so much on the Bushmen's mind that at night, while the others sleep, they keep their fire going, which means getting up to stoke it. If the glow-in-the-dark eyes of nightly predators are spotted, appropriate action will be taken, such as picking up a burning branch from the fire and waving it over one's head, making one look larger than life, while urging the predator in a calm but steady voice to go find something better to do. Bushmen do have courage, but pleading with predators hardly fits the idea of humans as the dominant species. The old way must have been quite successful, though, for even in the modern world, we still show the same tendency to come together for safety. At times of danger, we forget what divides us. This was visible, for example, after the 9/11 attack on the World Trade Center in New York, an unbelievably traumatic experience for those who lived through it. 9 months afterward, when asked how they saw relations between the races, New Yorkers of all races called those relations mostly good, whereas in foregoing years, they had called them mostly bad. The post-attack feeling of "We're in this together," had fostered unity in the city. These reflexes go back to the deepest, most ancient layers of our brain, layers that we share with many animals, not just mammals. Look at how fish, such as herring, swim in schools that tighten instantly when a shark or porpoise approaches, or how schools turn abruptly in one silvery flash, making it impossible for the predator to target any single fish. Schooling fish keep very precise individual distances, seek out companions of the same size, and perfectly match their speed and direction, often in a fraction of a second. Thousands of individuals thus act almost like a single organism. Or look at how birds, such as starlings, swarm in dense flocks that in an instant evade an approaching hawk. Biologists speak of selfish herds, in which each individual hides among a mass of others for its own security. The presence of other prey dilutes the risk for each one among them, not unlike the old joke about two men being chased by a bear. There's no need to run faster than the bear, so long as you outrun your pal. Even bitter rivals seek companionship at times of danger. Birds that in the breeding season fight one another to death over territory may end up in the same flock during migration. I know this tendency firsthand from my fish, each time I redo one of my large tropical aquariums. Many fish, such as cichlids, are quite territorial, displaying with spread fins and chasing one another to keep their corner free of intruders. I clean my tanks out every couple of years, during which time I keep the fish in a barrel. After a few days, they are released back into the tank, which by then looks quite different from before. I am always amused at how they suddenly seek out the company of their own kind. Like best buddies, the biggest fighters now swim side by side, exploring their new environment together. Until, of course, they start to feel confident again and claim a piece of real estate. Security is the first and foremost reason for social life. This brings me to the second false origin myth, that human society is the voluntary creation of autonomous men. The illusion here is that our ancestors had no need for anybody else. They led uncommitted lives. Their only problem was that they were so competitive that the cost of strife became unbearable. Being intelligent animals, they decided to give up a few liberties in return for community life. This origin story, proposed by French philosopher Jean-Jacques Rousseau as the social contract, inspired America's founding fathers to create the land of the free. It is a myth that remains immensely popular in political science departments and law schools, since it presents society as a negotiated compromise rather than something that came naturally to us. Granted, it can be instructive to look at human relations as if they resulted from an agreement among equal parties. It helps us think about how we treat or ought to treat one another. It's good to realize, though, that this way of framing the issue is a leftover from pre-Darwinian days, based on a totally erroneous image of our species. As is true for many mammals, every human life cycle includes stages at which we either depend on others, when we are young, old, or sick, or others depend on us, when we care for the young, old, or sick. We very much rely on one another for survival. It is this reality that ought to be taken as a starting point for any discussion about human society, not the reveries of centuries past, which depicted our ancestors as being as free as birds and lacking any social obligations. We descend from a long line of group-living primates with a high degree of interdependence. How the need for security shapes social life became clear when primatologists counted long-tailed macaques on different islands in the Indonesian archipelago. Some islands have cats, such as tigers and clouded leopards, whereas others don't. The same monkeys were found traveling in large groups on islands with cats, but in small groups on islands without. Predation thus forces individuals together. Generally, the more vulnerable a species is, the larger its aggregations. Ground-dwelling monkeys, like baboons, travel in larger groups than tree dwellers, which enjoy better escape opportunities. And chimpanzees, which because of their size have little to fear in the daytime, typically forage alone or in small groups. Few animals lack a herd instinct. When former U.S. Senate Majority Leader Trent Lott titled his memoir, Herding Cats, he was referring to the impossibility of reaching consensus. This may be frustrating when it comes to politicians, but for cats, it's entirely logical. Domestic cats are solitary hunters, so they don't need to pay much attention to one another. But all animals that either rely on one another for the hunt, such as members of the dog family, or are prey themselves, such as wildebeests, have a need to coordinate movements. They tend to follow leaders and conform to the majority. When our ancestors left the forest and entered an open, dangerous environment, they became prey and evolved a herd instinct that beats that of many animals. We excel at bodily synchrony and actually derive pleasure from it. Walking next to someone, for example, we automatically fall into the same stride. We coordinate chants and waves during sporting events, oscillate together during pop concerts, and take aerobics classes where we all jump up and down to the same beat. As an exercise, try to clap after a lecture when no one else is clapping, or try not to clap when everyone else is. We are group animals to a terrifying degree. Since political leaders are masters at crowd psychology, history is replete with people following them en masse into insane adventures.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.